Father. Praise you, Father. Oh, we look unto you in all your glory and fullness and wonder. Hallelujah. Knowing that all that we have need of is found in you, Lord. Praise you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We praise you. We praise you this morning. Oh, it is our desire. It is our desire to follow after you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Glory.
I just want to encourage you this morning. Stay with God. You know, the enemy comes. He brings things on our path as our in our walk with God. Stay with God. Don't let him get you sidetracked. Don't let him throw something in your life that will cause you to walk away from the very life and existence of the Father God. Oh, sabati kibo suna batande besete. Sula bandur sibirida diko sotandi piti kutso sabata. Esune me yo sula libiso kikakato sototo bata. Sidene me headed ya sote anime su kabatote sai.
Yeah, it's not too late. It's not too late to gird yourself up and to follow after the Lord. It's not too late to turn once again and to run the race once laid before thee, says the Lord. Do not allow the enemy to trick you and to deceive you in your mind, thinking that all is lost and that the cost is too great to once again take up the call and take up the mantle and to take up the purpose for which God designed you. But run once again the race and see the hand of the Lord come on thee once again, and you'll runs with strength, you'll run with anointing, and you'll run and finish your course, and great will be the joy in your house, and great will be the joy in your life, and the days in the ahead of you will be greater than the days behind you, and you'll know that the Lord has restored you to that which he once spoke unto you that you've let slide, but no longer let it slide. Take it up once again and see that which the Lord has in store for you, and great rejoicing shall be all around you, says the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Glory to God. Amen.
Glory.
Can you say amen?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, it's just, you know, so oftentimes we get sidetracked and then we think it's too late. We just can't get back to where we need to be. Oh, hallelujah. I'll tell you, if you'll just take it up once again, God'll restore you.
Yes.
Did you know? Now listen, what do you think Samson's in the Bible for? He slew more in his death than he did in his life. That was what God was saying, that, you know, that it's not all lost. The purpose of Samson was fulfilled. Even in his death, he did what God called him to do and did it greater than he ever done in his whole life before. Even before the fall, before he had his eyes plucked out, before he'd been made a slave, before he had his hair sheared, before all those things happened, he only killed a certain number of Philistines. But in one day, God restored him. It doesn't take long for God to restore.
Amen.
Glory to God. It doesn't take long for God to restore.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
His hair grew out.
Amen.
Praise God.
Lord.
Hallelujah. And in one moment. In one moment, God restored all and put him back. And that now he's listed. Think about it. He'd been booted out of the heroes of faith.
Right.
Yeah.
And in one moment, he was put right back in. And of the few people that are listed there, there's only a certain number of people in Hebrews chapter 11. Samson's one of them.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. It's not too late.
No, amen.
I said it's not too late.
Amen. Praise God.
Oh, rakamasike ungas kabakamaski keke. Ha 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 ha. And the Lord says concerning this church that you've withstood the attacks, you've withstood the dry places, you've withstood all that the enemy has thrown at you, and you're still standing, says the Lord. Therefore, because you've been faithful and have not quit and have not given up, I will do that which I have said unto thee at the beginning and bring it to pass. Surely in the days ahead you'll see the hand of the Lord working mightily. And all that has been spoken and all that has been said shall surely come to pass. And I'll make a quick work of it, says the Lord, in the days ahead. And you'll rejoice greatly as a congregation. And you'll see that which the Lord is at work and doing. And you'll say, my. It's greater than I thought it could have ever been. But you'll know that it's been the Lord. It's been the Lord. It's been the Lord. So stand back. Watch with your faith. Watch and run and be a part. But know this. It's the Lord that's at work. It's the Lord that's at work. Yes. And I will do what I said I would do in the days prior to this. I will do that which I promised, says the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 I've had something stirring in me for a few days. The Lord's been dealing with me about something. God can use teaching tapes to talk to you. Did you know that? And I was listening to Dad Hagin. He was telling a story about somebody. And I heard that. I was about 3 o'clock in the morning. I just had him on all night. I forgot to hit the sleep timer. I got a 90-minute sleep timer on my little iPod clock thing. And I didn't hit it. And it just played all night long. And I woke up at 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning. And I heard, and got half asleep, heard this one story. And then ever since then, God's been talking to me.
Yeah.
About that. You know, praise God. I think he woke me up to hear that. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah. He nudged me. Hey, wake up, boy. Wait, boy, get up. Listen. Anyway, now I'm not going to tell you the story, but I'm going to tell you what he's dealing with me about. And so yesterday I told our outreach team yesterday, I said, well, now I got something I'm going to do. But when I get 100%, when I get a hold of it 100%, I got about 90%.
Yeah.
Not quite there yet. You know, you want to be in faith. So I'm on the front row this morning, and I kind of, praise God, I can do this. I was going to make a declaration that we're going to have a certain number of people by a certain date in Jesus' name. And I came up with a number. And the Lord said, well, you can have that. What if I tell you I'll give you more, give you this many? And I went, my head just went, well, you know, if the Lord says it, then I can believe God. Because he's faithful that promised. Now, I was going to say we're going to have 80. He said, how about 100? I said, well,
glory to God.
My mind wanted to go to the 80.
Yeah.
Why? It's easier.
Right.
But God said, I'll give you 100 if you'll make the declaration. So on Sunday, May the 13th, we'll have 100 people here.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Now, you going to do anything? Are you going to do some super duper beat major? No. I'm going to use my faith. Now, we're going to do what we're doing.
Yep.
We're going out in the streets. We're believing God. But I'm not going to do anything extra special to make it happen. I'm not under pressure. Why? He told me it happened. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put my faith out there, and I'm just going to say it every Sunday.
Yeah.
On May 13th, we'll have 100 people. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now see, the struggle I was having with this on a few days was, as God was dealing with me along this line, is, you know, we've tried so many things to get people to come in. He said, that's the problem. He said, you've tried this and that. You've tried to do this and you've tried to do that. He said, just believe me. Rest in me. And so I declare with the words of my mouth and believe in my heart that on Sunday, May the 13th, we'll have 100 people here.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Now, what are you going to do after May 13th? We ain't going to stop there. But, hallelujah. But what happens? All of our faith is going to rise. We're going to rise up together. Amen?
Amen.
So what's going to happen on Sunday, May the 13th? We're going to have 100 people. Now, it's not, listen, now I understand this, and listen, we just talked about this yesterday, and we're not going to do a special Philip Hugh Sunday on May the 13th. I get, well, that's fine to do. I've done that before, but we ate Western Round. But the Lord said, just say, we're going to have 100 people. How many can agree with me?
Amen.
How many can agree with me? If you can't agree with me, just shut up. Don't say anything. Don't say, oh, it'll never happen. Just shut up. Yeah, just sit here and watch.
Yeah.
Just sit back on the back row, cross your arms, and say, I don't believe it. Just don't say anything to anybody else.
Yeah, right. Good word.
All right? Just shut up.
Yeah, right.
Let the rest of us go. Put yourself in neutral. We'll pull you.
Yeah, uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So, Pastor, you're putting yourself out there. You've tried this, and we hadn't got there. You know, we used to have more than 100 people. We had 100, about 125, 30 people one time, and things have happened. And I didn't realize it. I let that affect my faith.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were faithful to preach the word. We were faithful to go on and do the things we were supposed to do. But I let it affect my faith to the point I wasn't saying certain things.
Yeah.
Well, God's corrected me. Sunday, May 13th. Now next Sunday, I'm going to get up saying on next Sunday, on May the 13th, we're going to have 100 people.
Amen.
And the following Sunday, no, I won't say it. Well, I'll say it in Tulsa. Janie will say it. Because I'll be in Tulsa the following Sunday. Hallelujah. But we might Skype in. Just so I can go, on Sunday, May the 13th, we're going to have 100 people. Hallelujah. I get the kids to use their iPhones. I'll be over at Raymond Churchill that day. I'll be at Winter Bible Seminar. And then the following week, I'm teaching at Raymond for a week. So, praise the Lord. All right. You got anything else?
Uh-uh.
So, what's happening on Sunday, May 13th? 100 people here. Amen. Glory to God. I said, if you have not been able to be here for all of our services, you can go to our website, fvc.org, and you can either listen to our audio services or you can watch our video services. And we're on YouTube also, so if you've got YouTube, you can log in and pick us up on YouTube. We're on Roku. Basically, you can pretty much pick us up with any of the formats out there and watch us. If you've got Roku, you can watch us on the big screen because we film in HD, and so you can watch it on your big screen TV, and it's good clear clarity. If you've got a Roku box, or if you've got a DVD player or something that picks up YouTube videos. Hallelujah. We podcast, so you can set up to download those to your iPods. You can download those to your iPod touches and so forth that have video. You can pick those all up, watch all that on there, okay? Hallelujah. And then tonight at 6:30 will be our communion and healing service. We'll be receiving the Lord's table tonight. We'll also be teaching along some lines to do with healing or faith for healing or something along those lines. And then we'll be laying hands on the sick. So if you know sick folk, bring them. Amen. So, Pastor Ed, you're going to have a special Kenneth Hagin anointing? Brother Hagin had the Kenneth Hagin anointing, the brother Jesus gave to him. Listen, I'll tell you something. If there's not a special anointing, we still lay hands on people in faith.
Yes.
According to the word of God.
Yes.
Amen. And if people want us to, we've got oil up here. We can just dump some oil on your head and pray for you. Hallelujah. All those ways work. Faith, laying on hands, anointing with oil, special anointings. Hallelujah. I'll know this much. Bring prayer cloths. You got people you can't get here? Bring prayer cloths. We'll lay hands on those. We've seen miracles take place with prayer cloths. Hallelujah. We believe God, that God does what he said he would
last
do in his
Sunday,
work.
Last Sunday, I
attempted to close this series. Last Sunday, I failed. But what's new? What does it mean when Pastor Ed says he's about to close? Absolutely nothing. That's right. Hallelujah. It means absolutely nothing. Of course, now you can't have what you say. Glory to God. I am the master of the 7 attempt closing. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. And we love y'all. If you're a little chilly, I empathize with you, but it is smoking hot on this platform right now. So we need to either turn this unit on circulating or something and maybe turn that unit off out in the hallway. If the nursery's warm enough, if it's not, then just get this unit circulating some kind of air. Whew. I mean, I feel like I'm in the Sahara Desert. Y'all here, y'all go home. Y'all out there? How many are born again? How many love Jesus? How many are filled with the Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Acts chapter 2. This is our foundation text for the teaching we're doing. And we will be, I am really planning on closing today, this teaching. And then next Sunday we'll minister something. I probably won't start a series next Sunday since I'll be gone the following Sunday. I don't like to do that. And I don't just do series just to do series. If that's what's on my heart to do. But if God gives me a series of single messages, we'll just do a series of single messages.
Yeah.
We follow the Holy Ghost. All right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Fans everywhere. Glory to God. Everybody say Shanda. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 2. Verse 41, it says, then they that gladly received the word were baptized. And let me say something, folks. If you don't receive the word, it won't work for you.
Amen.
Did you know the book of Acts and chapter, I mean not book of Acts, the book of Hebrews in chapter 10, talking about the children of Israel, said this, the word did not profit them not being, the word preached did not profit them not being mixed with faith.
Yeah, right.
Said it did not profit them not being mixed with faith. And if you'll read the Hebrews, it talks about how they were, the things they did and the things that were written about them were written as examples for us. I said they were written as examples for us.
Yeah.
Are y'all here? You're going home. And so don't think that things are going to happen for you if you don't mix faith with the word. Actually, if you're here with us Wednesday night, you need to go back and listen to Wednesday night. We talked about how that be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Isn't that what it says in James, the first chapter, verse 21, 22, 23? It says, be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. And so if you don't mix faith with the word preached, it's not going to work for you. I said, if you don't mix faith with it, it won't work for you. Amen. And so we go on reading here in verse 41. It says, and they that gladly received the his word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they, that who? They that got added, continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, koinonia, and in breaking of bread, that is communion, and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. Look at the last verse here. Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added. This is what the Lord spoke to me. The Lord added. The Lord added to the church.
Yeah.
The Lord added to the church. That's what he spoke to me about when I was thinking along this lines of, yeah, because I was thinking, now, Lord, you know, we're supposed to be out, you know, I mean, we're supposed to do some campaigns and all this kind of stuff. And he just kept bringing, every time I think about how we could get the church to grow, I read this scripture a few weeks ago. And every time I'd get to thinking along that line, he'd go, the Lord added to the church. The Lord added to the church. Everybody say, the Lord added.
The Lord added.
Who added?
The Lord,
the Lord added. Hallelujah. To the church daily, such as should be saved.
Amen.
The Lord added. Glory to God. Amen. Well, we got our teaching of this series out of this passage of Scripture. They continued in the apostles' doctrine. So we started out on the first Sunday of January talking about, you know, the mission of the church is to evangelize the lost. Now listen. It is not the mission of the church building to evangelize the lost. The church is not a soul-saving center, so to speak. You're supposed to go out and win the lost. You're going to go in the highways and byways and compel them to come in. Y'all hear you going home. It is the, you know, some people think that the church is supposed to, you know, we got one of the biggest, quote, churches in America right now growing like crazy. But they say on their website, if you're coming here to get disciples, you're in the wrong place. We're just about winning souls. Well, Jesus said, go into all the world and make disciples of all men. How can you say if you're coming here to get disciples, you're in the wrong place? We're just about winning people. Jesus didn't even say go save the world. He said go make disciples.
Yeah.
I like to stay with the word.
Amen.
I don't like to be cute. I like to stay with the word. Now, staying with the word is not always popular, but I like to stay with the word.
Yeah.
Why? Because the word works.
Yeah.
I said the word works.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And so we are to evangelize. We are. Listen, if you'll... How can we just do a wrap up of the series and get done in the same day? This is my second attempt. It might be my second of three. Well, anyway, y'all enjoyed that. Hallelujah. Praise God. What was I going to say now? Because I got off on that. But, you know, the Word of God teaches us. There we go. That's it. That's what I was looking for. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Look over into the fourth chapter of the book of Ephesians. I'm now digressing from my notes. What's new? Hallelujah. Somebody said, oh, it's so cute, Pastor. He brings his notes to the pulpit. Hallelujah. He brings them up there like he's really going to use them. Ephesians chapter 4. Looking here, we'll just go ahead and pick up in verse 4. There is one body and one spirit, even as you're called into one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Stop there. This is not Jesus only. There is only one Lord you're saved under. There's only one faith you're saved by, and there's only one baptism in to get into the body of Christ. We know there's multiple baptisms in the New Testament. There's baptism into the body, there's baptism in water, and there's baptism in the Holy Spirit. Those are all terms used. But when he's talking about here coming into the body, there is one Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. There is one faith, the faith to believe that God raised him from the dead and confess him as your Lord. There is one baptism. There is one baptism by the Spirit into the body of Christ concerning salvation. This is what this is saying. This is not, you know, if you take this out and go build a whole doctrine, oh, there's only one baptism. You got to be baptized in the name of Jesus only. Be born again, filled with the Spirit, and speak in tongues. You're not saved. That's that. People get crazy with stuff. Stop. Don't get crazy with stuff. Don't take isolated scriptures or a few scriptures here and there and run off on a tangent that just leaves every other scripture in the Bible out in the dust.
Yeah, right.
Amen. Then when you read a scripture that seems in your thinking to either contradict or go crossways what you believe, you've got to really take an evaluation of what you believe. Because the Word of God doesn't contradict itself. It balances itself.
Yeah.
Not compromise. Now, bobbleheads. Has anybody figured out where to get those Pastor Ed bobblehead dolls at yet? I want everybody to have them in the back window. Pastor Ed bobblehead dolls. All right. So, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. In other words, however God's gifted you or God's called you, he's graced you for that work. If God called you to work in the nursery till Jesus comes out, you're graced for it.
Yeah, right.
Now, here's the problem. We get to thinking in our head, I want a position that more people see me, or I want a position that's more notable. I want a position that's higher up. See, if you go get in a position you're not graced for, you don't want to be there. Hello? One minister one time, tremendous healing ministry. Even got the false teaching he got and got it and picked up his last name. They called it such and suchism. I won't call his name. And because it's not profitable. I mean, he's long been gone home to be with the Lord. You know, his works followed him, but, you know, his faith got him in, but his you know, some of the things he was teaching was causing problems. But they, Brother Gordon Lindsay, founder of Christ for the Nations,
yeah.
And had the magazine, it's called Christ for the Nations now, but before then it was called the Healing Evangel or something. But all the healing evangelists except Oral Roberts advertised at it, because Oral Roberts had his own. And Brother Lindsay went to this minister and said, you know, don't try to teach. You're not a teacher. He said, yeah, but I want to. See, he wasn't graced for teaching. He's called to preach healing and minister healing and had great success. But he found out that people like to hear teachers, and so he wanted to teach. He wasn't graced for it. Cost him his ministry. Cost him his life at an earlier age than he should have. If you're not graced for it, don't try to step in. You don't want a pastor if you're not called to. You get a lot of young whippersnappers coming to a church and they think, I can do a better job than that pastor. They want to take over. If you're not graced for it, baby, you don't want it.
Oh, you got
it. Yeah, I'll just tell you that right straight up. That went over big. He's given us great verse 8. Wherefore he saith, when he led up on, send it up on high, he led captivity captive, gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it first but that he descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some. He didn't say he gave everybody. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Listen to this. Now, some people read that as four gifts. You know, the pastor, teachers, one. I don't care how you do it. It doesn't matter. There's apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, or pastors and teachers. Okay? There's ministry gifts out there. You'll know if you're called to it.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. All right? Let's not split hairs over how many there are.
Right.
All right? Now, the next verse is what I'm after. For the perfecting. Now, the word perfecting in the Greek is really better translated maturing. The ministry gifts are given to grow the body, to help develop and mature the body. What for? For the work of the ministry. If you read it in different translations, you'll see how the Greek construction is here. It is that the ministry gifts are given to perfect or mature the saints so that the saints can go out and do the work of the ministry.
Exactly right.
For the edifying of the body of Christ. You're supposed to be a soul winner.
Right.
You can't pay somebody to take your place.
No.
Hello. Well, my job is to usher in the church. I don't alleviate you from coming out and going out and winning people to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Can I get at least one grunt? Can I get a pig sound or something? I mean, just some kind of noise. Let me know you're breathing. Yes. No, see, a lot of people say, well, wait, that's what we pay that preacher for. Ain't what you pay me for. You don't pay me in the first place. I put my money in that church. You give your money to Jesus.
Yeah, that's right. Go ahead.
See, that's what people got to get over. It ain't your money to start with.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It's the Lord's.
Yeah.
Hello?
We'll keep going.
It's the Lord's.
Amen.
The tithe don't belong to you. And if you're putting it anywhere else other than where he said it, you stole it.
Right.
I need at least a mini choir up here. I need me a bunch of elves up here that can all go, hallelujah. I mean, every time I say something really good, you know? Hallelujah. See if y'all can find something somewhere online or something. Get me a mini elf choir. All right. Now, listen, you are called, you are not absolved from your call to be a soul winner. Let me tell you what, 90% of people won to the kingdom of God should be coming in because you're out in the highways and the byways winning people to Jesus. Now, I didn't say shove it down their throat. I didn't say go get into somebody's window and get you a Bible and start out like a crazy man. Start going, you generation of vipers and snakes. You know what the Hispanics say? Ay, yay, yay. The French? Ooh la la. The African American church? Help me, Jesus. All right. White folks? They don't say nothing. They just stare at you. All right. Hello. They some stiff. Anyway, let's move along before I get myself in real trouble. No, you are to be perfected by the ministry gifts so you can go out and do the work of the ministry.
Exactly right, Pastor.
You're to be a soul winner. Evangelism is not, listen, understand this. We do it all the time. But true biblical evangelism is not having a bunch of services and some cool music and everybody coming in week after week after week and getting a bunch of people coming and getting saved and nobody's getting discipled. You're to be going in the highways and byways to get them saved and bring them to the church so they can get discipled. The church is supposed to be discipling them. Why? Because the very first thing it says is they continue steadfast in back over in Acts 2:42. They continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine. That is discipling people in the things of God. I'm telling you, one of the worst things we do to people, we've done evangelistic crusades all over the world. I remember a number of years ago, an evangelist friend of ours was in Africa and getting thousands, tens of thousands of people saved. And he realized after a period of time, there was another man, a friend of mine, John Nuzzo used to preach here. He's pastoring now, so he didn't go out like he did. But John went for 18 months to Africa just to help establish churches and pastors for all these people getting saved. They'd have little churches of 80 people, have 1,200 people at the end of a six-week crusade. Because people just showed up there, and they didn't know what to do with them. Amen? So he went in and helped train pastors and started helping. He'd stay after the meeting for weeks and help train pastors and help build, get churches going and train people so they could handle and disciple the converts, those 19 converts, those that got saved. See? The church is about bringing people in so we can continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and grow. Amen. Don't think we're not doing our job because we don't have, 45,000 people getting saved on Sunday because of our evangelistic crusade church. Mm-hmm. A church is to win, is to disciple people in the things of God. You're to be out there winning people to the lost.
Yeah, that's right.
Now we're going knocking on doors, we're doing stuff. Okay, that's that. We're doing those things, but that's outside. That's still outside.
Yeah.
Hello? Mm-hmm. So, we're continuing the doctrine of the church. Koinonia, we talked about that, how we're supposed to have that fellowship around Jesus Christ, breaking bread, having communion. What's so important about communion is it keeps people walking in love, because you can't receive the Lord's table without walking in love and do it right. Well, I've heard people teach that if you didn't rightly discern the Lord's table, you weren't discerning the Lord's blood was for forgiveness of sin, the body was for the healing of your body. That's true. But the other side of it, which is what Paul was dealing with in that whole chapter, if you read it in chapter context, the main import of rightly discerning the Lord's body is walking in love one towards another. So they were continually breaking the bread in communion, the Holy Eucharist, communion, the Lord's table, whatever your church calls it. The command And the teaching surrounding that demanded you walk in love and forgiveness and restoration one towards another. You couldn't take the table in proper context without walking in love. And if you didn't walk in love, the Word of God says if you don't judge yourself, you'd be judged. And for this cause, many are weak, sickly, and many sleep. Let me put that in modern English. There's some sick folk, there's some weak folk, and there's some dead folk because they didn't judge themselves about walking in love when they came to the Lord's table. Then we dealt with this a few weeks ago. I know it went over big, but it's still true. I can't help it. I'm not going to preach stuff that goes over just so you'll be happy and shout and put big offerings in. I'm going to teach the Word.
Yeah.
Now, if you stop giving because you got the Word, you don't like it. One lady told Brother Hagin one time, said, "If I," because he told her something she didn't want to hear, "if I didn't like you so much, I'd stop tithing." He said, "Well, you're wrong again, because if you're tithing because you like me, you're missing the mark there. You're supposed to tithe because God's Word says so. You love the Lord." he really upset her. Spun her up. Praise God. But wait, now, the communion table. It's so important in the life of the church. I said it's so important. How can you say you love God and hate your brother who you do see? Wow, I don't hate him, I'm walking in love. I'm going to tell you something. It's easy to say I'm walking in love and not act like it. Now, can I get a holy grunt? Can I get you going? I mean something. Are y'all just going to look at me? I'm going to keep preaching this.
Keep going.
If you're walking, listen. Well, how do I measure if I'm really walking in love or not? Walk in love the way God walks in love. Measure your love walk not against what you believe the Lord told you. I hear people tell me all the time, "Well, the Lord showed me this and the Lord showed me that." I'm going to tell you about 90% of what people say the Lord showed them, their flesh showed them. Mm-hmm. And they put the Lord on it to gain approval from everybody else.
Amen.
Hello? Well, how do you know that? Because it don't line up with the Word. If it lines up, if it don't line up with the Word, the Lord didn't show you. I've had people say, find all kinds of excuses why they don't have to walk in love. They say, "Well, the Lord showed me." The Lord didn't show you how to not walk in love. Hello? Now just smile, and nobody in this room will know that we're talking to you. Smile real big. You can see the teeth. Hallelujah. Find out who's been using Crest Super Whitener. Hallelujah. Now, the communion table, they broke bread because it kept the fellowship of love. It kept love in the church. People had to judge themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Hello? You know, got an interesting scripture. I think what I'm doing is I'm going to summarize my series here. How about that? We're going to skip. We spent a lot of time on that communion thing. So not communion, but the koinonia, the fellowship. But we may not get that one real deep. But y'all hear on this love thing? You know, Jesus says something real interesting. Well, let's look over there. Find it, because I don't have my notes. You find it. When you bring your gift to the altar.
Yeah.
Anybody know where that is right off?
No.
Somebody use a concordance. Because I don't have a clue where it is right off. I love it when the Lord gives me a scripture and I don't even know where it is right off. Now I got to wait for somebody to find it. All right, somebody's about to start using PC Study Bible in the congregation. If you find it, just tell me. Don't be bashful. Love that. What's that, Bill? You know, when you bring your gift to the altar, if you have aught against your brother, leave it there. Go and deal with that and then come back and then bring your gift to God. Matthew 5:23. Let's look over there. Here we go. Matthew 5, 23. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar and, there remem- and thou rememberest that thy brother hath aught against it. Well, he didn't say if you got aught against your brother. He said if he's got something against you. My. Listen. It's not talking about you just got a revelation. You've been ticked off with your brother. Say if you know they're ticked off with you.
Yeah.
He has aught against it. Go to the next verse. What's it? Leave thy gift before the altar. Go thy way and first be reconciled to thy brother. Wow. Then come and offer thy gift. Now that's hard, Pastor Ed. You're preaching something's hard. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. I just heard you. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. I just heard you say it. No, Jesus said it. The head of the church, the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the one you follow, they'll say, Jesus, I love you. Oh, Jesus, I love you. You're so wonderful, Lord. He said, what? Because love in the church is vital to its health.
Mm-hmm.
I said, love in the church is vital to its health. You can't have people sitting in church mad and hating each other. Now, I'm going to tell you something. If somebody's name spins you up and gets you over into overdrive, there's a problem. And you need to deal with it. Now, listen. You got to understand, not always that certain, you know, I mean, some things you're not going to be able to fix.
Amen.
If somebody's been married, divorced, and remarried, you can't fix that. We're going to divorce the person with that, go back and marry. You can't, if you can't fix that stuff.
Yeah.
There are repercussions in the natural for certain events, but you can get it straight.
Yeah, right.
And get the spiritual side straight and get back in love.
Yeah, thank God.
Amen. You can get back in the love walk concerning it. Hello? Do you guys mind if I use your situation?
No, go ahead.
Yeah, you don't care? Now we all know Greg's divorced, and him and his first wife didn't have an amiable, relationship after the divorce. I mean, it was a constant battle over the kids and custody and, you know, this and all this kind of stuff. And they got back in the church down here. Gina came in. He married Gina, married her. They came to church, got saved. First Sunday she was here, I asked who wanted to get baptized in the Holy Ghost. She jumped up. I thought she was filled with the Holy Ghost the way she was acting the whole service. God instantly filled her with the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Praise God. Well, now her and his ex-wife are good friends. It's kind of interesting. They call and talk on the phone and carry on, you know. You know, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
But you know what? They were down here for CAMS.
Graduation.
And you know, it was really interesting because they got along so well. Everybody's getting along well. I mean, the ex-in-laws and the in-laws and all. Everybody's in the house. And everybody's just, it was all good. And it wasn't always that way. But somewhere in there, they made a decision. They're going to walk in love.
Amen.
And walk according to the word. And God did a miracle. And that relationship, they get along. I mean, it was interesting. I mean, actually, I brought up a church I used to be in when they were married. And they got all talk about it. And then Greg went, this is a little too weird. Because they kind of got talking like they were still married. And it got weird, you know. And so they kind of backed that off. But you know what? It should be. Now, listen. You can't fix the fact that they're remarried. Both of them remarried. You don't divorce everybody and put everybody back together. Mm-hmm. That's not how you fix. That's not full restoration.
Okay.
But God has restored on the spiritual side. There's a love walk.
Yeah.
They can be in each other's company, and it's godly. They talk about the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
There's no fighting.
Thank God.
You see, you understand what I'm trying to say? Yeah, thank you for letting me use that, because that's a good example. And, you know, because I remember when they first came, Greg was saying, I've got it. It's a tough thing. And we've watched God just turn that whole thing around. And it was, I mean, it's just a pleasure to be, you know, to sit in the house and have this situation. You know, obviously you don't ever want to have things happen. Things happen.
Mm-hmm.
We understand that. Human beings do things. Okay? They just do things.
Mm-hmm.
They're people. They do stuff. But you know what? We're Christians. And if we're born again, then we got to learn, we got to walk according to the word. Amen?
Right.
Oh, there may be some personal, intimate things there that got down in your soul and hurt. But you know what? He restoreth your soul.
Thank God.
All that emotional junk, he can take care of that. Are y'all here? When the psalmist said he restoreth my soul, he wasn't talking about you getting saved. See, you get born again. You don't get a restored spirit. You get a new spirit. Mm-hmm. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. And behold, all things have become new. But your soul, I'm telling you, there's wounds and there's injuries and there's emotions in the soul of men and women that it takes God working in that. And how does he work in that? Receive with meekness the engrafted word of God, which is able to save. And the word save is sozo. One of the meanings of sozo is restoration. Restore your soul. Hallelujah. Your suke. Your soul. The word of God will bring a restoration to the emotions, to the hurt, to the pain. But it means you have to walk in love and forgiveness. Now go to Mark 11:25 in your Bibles. How many know Mark 11:22, 23, and 24? Therefore I say unto you, have faith in God. For verily I say that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, hallelujah, but believe that the things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. 99.9% of people like to stop right there in verse 24. But verse 25 starts out, and now understand, chapter and verse was added by man. They're not in the original. This is one continuous thought. The word and is a conjunction. Now, in mathematical terminology, whenever you have an and, it means both sides of the equation has to be correct for it to be true. If I say 2 plus 2 equals 4 and 3 plus 3 equals 7, that statement is false. Why? Because the word and means that both sides have to be true. Now, if I said 3 plus 3 equals 6 and 2 plus 2 equals or 2 plus 2 equals 5, that's still a true statement because one side is and it says or. That's how math, that's how those words work, and that's how they do a mathematical equation. And same thing here. What things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. And when ye stand praying, forgive. 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 I'll tell you what. If you're forgiven and they still make you mad just looking at them, you ain't forgiving them.
Amen.
I don't care what you say. I know what's in my heart. I don't care what you say. If you can't be in the presence of somebody that's done you wrong without getting thermal overload, you haven't forgiven them. I'll argue with you all day long on that. You might get mad and pull a gun and shoot at me. I don't care. I'm telling the truth. Forgiveness. Can you imagine God? God, I forgave you a character, but I'll tell you what, you still tick me off what you did. Can you imagine the Lord doing that to you? We all want the Lord to forgive us, absolutely.
Yeah, right.
Well, I'm going to tell you what, if you're in real forgiveness, it'll be like the Lord's. I said, it'll be like the Lord's. I understand trust is earned. I mean, if you've stolen from me, I'm not going to turn my pocket. I may love you and forgive you. I'm not going to hold it against you. But I don't mean I'm going to leave my wallet out for you to go through again.
Yeah, right. Exactly right.
But I'm not mad at you. I'm not angry every time I see you. You stole my money before. Trust is earned. But trust, that's different.
It is different. Right.
If you can't be in somebody's presence without being so mad you wanna chop their head off with a guillotine or guillotine, you're not in forgiveness.
Amen.
I said you're not in forgiveness. Biblical forgiveness. Well, look back here in Mark 11. He says, and when you stand praying, forgive if what? If ye have aught. Now remember, over there in Matthew 5, he says, when you come to the altar, if you know your brother has aught against you. Let me put it like this. If there's something between you and somebody, it don't matter what side it's on, you got to deal with it. All right. Bobblehead me. Come on. Y'all are the most disobedient church. I command you in Jesus' name to bobblehead. Hallelujah. So, in Matthew 5, if your brother has aught, you got to go deal with it. Mark 11, if you have aught, you got to go deal with it. So if there's aught, you got to be dealt with. Come on now. And when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any. Why? I know grace people don't like this. That your Father which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. Well, God's not going to base my forgiveness on whether I forgive or not. Oh, yeah. Let me tell you something. If you're in unforgiveness, you're in sin. And as long as you're in unforgiveness, you're in sin. And as long as you're committing the sin of unforgiveness, God can't forgive you for your unforgiveness because you're continuing to act on it. Oh, I heard the mini choir. No, I mean, the chief elf said, "Preach, Pastor!" Hallelujah. No, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven, which is in heaven, forgive you your trespasses. Why? Because when you're walking in unforgiveness, it is a perpetual act of sin. It is a continuing act of sin to walk in unforgiveness. Yeah. And until you deal with that, God can't deal with yours. Now, I probably expect to see most of you in the healing line tonight because your toes just got stomped on. We're having a special service just to pray for folks tonight. So you can come on and bring them hurting feet up here. Y'all know I'm preaching right.
Yeah.
But people don't like to hear this. No. We've got special revelations. You don't get special revelations that put you outside the Word of God.
Right.
Let me tell you something. Can I share something with y'all? I've shared this story before. A number of years ago, our church was really doing good. I mean, we were on our way someplace, and this traveling minister came to me and wanted to have lunch with me. He wanted to take me out to lunch because he wanted to introduce his ministry to me. Yeah, you know, when you're young in ministry, you don't know everything you know now. You just manipulate. You just want to get my pulpit in my church and preach. And I'm glad you never got in my pulpit. You snake. Are you mad at? No. He calls all kinds of problems, all kinds of churches. Anyway, and then he said, "Well, I want to have a place for my family to go when I'm out of town." Well, fine. Praise God, brother. You got a place to come, visit, you know, get ministered to. Praise God. He told me he played the horn like Phil Driscoll and preached like Kenneth Copeland.
Wow.
Now, that's one dynamite package.
Yeah.
Nobody plays the horn like Phil Driscoll. Except Phil Driscoll. The man can blow a horn. They asked Doc Severson one time on the Tonight Show a number of years ago. They said, what's it like to be the greatest trumpet player in the world? He said, "I don't know. You'll have to ask Phil Driscoll." Driscoll can blow a horn. Still can blow a horn. I bet his wife kisses him is like kissing sandpaper. Because that upper lip is like callous all to pieces. Anyway, hallelujah. But, you know, by and by, time goes by. And we had some people in church coming to church. I mean, we got people off. We had this influx of people. This one couple, they were living together. They were interracial couple, you know, and they like adopted kids and foster kids, and she was a mule. They were selling drugs and doing drugs and living together and all kinds of stuff. Mm. They came in, got saved, and baptized in the Holy Ghost. I went down to the courthouse and argued in her behalf. She had been trafficking cocaine. Now listen, she didn't have simple possession. She was trafficking.
Yeah.
She was a mule. She had enough cocaine in her possession when they arrested her. They could have just kind of just put her away and locked up the cell and turned out the lights and said, you know, when you come back out, you'll be an albino. You know, you won't be able to see. You'll be blind. I mean, they could have just locked her away forever. I went down and talked, and they testified. You know, listen, I know about courthouse. This girl's gotten saved. I mean, they're getting married. Hallelujah. We're getting married. They're going to marry them. I mean, they're born again, loving God. I mean, they're in church every time the doors are open. Hallelujah. The judge let her off with probation. And listen, it wasn't fake. They kept coming to church, serving the Lord, love God. Well, then her dad got sick. In the hospital. Now listen, we have a pretty much a standard. If you have a relative in the hospital, if they don't ask me to come visit them, I don't go visit them.
All right, yeah.
Particularly when they're a member of another church.
Well, sure, right.
That's ministerial ethics. You just don't go visit other people's members.
Right.
It's just wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
If they ask you to come, it doesn't matter. That's their request. They got the right to ask you to come. But I mean, you know, just go visit. And I didn't go. And this guy, when he started going up there and ministering to her. Well, next thing you know, they had about half the church up there talking about how Pastor Ed was evil and wasn't coming up there and visiting her daddy and all this kind of stuff. And I said, look, if he wants me to come, you get him to ask for me to come and I'll come. Yeah. He never asked for me to come. Why? He's got a pastor.
Right.
He's got a pastor. They don't believe like we believe. That's not my business.
Mm-hmm.
It won't do me any good to go there and try to get him changed over if he's got a pastor and don't believe like we believe in the first place. Unless you can get him to change. And I'm going to say, people be courteous to you. If somebody asks you to come and you go visit, you're just wasting their time and everybody else's time. Because if they don't want you up there, they might just smile and look at the TV around you. I've had them do that. I mean, you move over here and they move the other way. They're trying to see what's happening on as the stomach churns. Oh, the old and the relentless. Hello. Fell off the edge of darkness. Are y'all here? How about this one? Dark Shadows. The vampire soap opera.
Oh, yeah.
Before vampires were popular. Anyway. So he got involved, stirred up a bunch of mess, and split the church wide open. I'd go out here and preach. This used to be set up as two separate sections. We had a section with an aisle against the wall, and a big middle section, middle aisle. And that's how we had it set up. We got these chairs. We changed the setup. I like this better. But we had a big, and that couple, one of the couples involved in it, was sitting right there on that second row. I'll tell you how God's so full of mercy. For about 6 weeks before this thing blew up, finally completely blew up, I'd walk up to him and I'd look right at him and I'd say, you know, people always say the grass is greener on the other side. And start talking about people doing stuff. And I had no idea what was going on in the church. Mm. The color would go out of their face. Hello?
Mm.
And they'd all get back at the back of the church after service and say, who told Pastor Ed? Nobody. I didn't know what was going on. I'm preaching stuff. I'm nailing their secret sessions to the wall during church services. And they couldn't figure out God was trying to tell them something. Mm-hmm. They thought somebody was a spy and come. Yeah, yeah, there's a spy. The Holy Ghost was telling off on them. Well, they just split the church all to pieces. I mean, we lost over half the congregation. I mean, it was so bad financially, we thought we were going to have to close the doors. I mean, we just hung on with every ounce of faith we had just to keep the doors open. Start talking about my wife. Now, I tell you what, I got in the flesh. Mm-hmm. I'm ready to go punch their eyeballs out.
I feel you.
They volunteered to come to our house and help my wife clean. They want to be a blessing. So they come over and they mop the floor, vacuum a couple times. And then, you know what they said? She just sits home and does nothing. Well, you ask if you could come over and do this to bless us. So we said, now I'll tell you what, it took my wife years to let anybody walk in our house to help us again.
I bet.
Because she won't let anybody use that as a leverage to speak against us. Oh, yeah. Started running her down. She ain't done nothing. Yeah. She just sits around, let us work. Well, what did you ask to come over and help?
That's right.
Well, the devil is crazy. Well, he got all involved in this mess. He's the one that, he started the church. All these people went over there. And then they started calling everybody that had ever been in our church and said, come over, here's the pastor from Jeremiah. God sent to Greensboro to gather up all the sheep Pastor Ed scattered. And they had the Pastor Ed scattered sheep church. Until he got caught in adultery in his office at 2:00 in the morning.
Uh-huh.
Now, how did you feel about him? Every time I saw him, I wanted to take my fist and stick it about that far down his throat. I did. And he was at all, anytime Brother Hagin was around, he was around. And he'd walk up and grab my arm and say, I love you, brother. And I'm thinking, I want to show you the love of God, buddy. The only thing that's kept me from hitting, I'm going to tell you, the only thing that kept me from hitting him then was the thought of the headline flashing across my mind on the Greensboro News and Record, local pastor beats local pastor up.
Yeah.
At traveling minister Kenneth E. Hagin's meeting. I'm telling you, anger. I'd just see him and I'd get so mad, I'd about bite my tongue in half. He'd send us money. He'd send checks in the mail.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. I don't want no blood money. No? I didn't cash them. We were at Brother Hagin meeting. We were at camp meeting, 19 something. Bigger man than you. We're at camp meeting. And he walks up to me on one day and grabs me and says, "I love you, brother." I'm thinking, I'm going to take you and throw you over the balcony. I'm so mad. You just burn me up. And I walk in and walk into the Coliseum that day, and Brother Hagin starts preaching on love. Oh, yeah. Walking in love. Camp meeting, 19-something, 88, I don't know what year it was, 87, 6, I don't remember what year it was. Yeah, no, it couldn't be that early, because it was 92, 93, something like that. Walking in love! He's talking about walking up, and Janie starts taking her elbow, going, wham! What you going to do about that? Wham! What you going to do about that? Wham! What you going to do? And I'm thinking, shut up, woman. I mean, I'm getting beat with the word, getting beat by my wife, and then I had to deal with that bozo. Because tell me he loves me. And so I'm sitting there stewing. Lord, it ain't right. I got to forgive him. They talked about my wife. They hurt our church. They're all over there. They got all these people over there making fun of us, talking about how wonderful he is. It's not right. I'm arguing with the Lord. Now, you deal with him and I'll forgive him. Me and the Lord having a discussion. Say, Pastor Ed, did you? Yeah, I did that. And Brother Hagin just kept preaching on love. We walk out of the Coliseum. We were standing down at the Williams Center with Adams Mark, I believe it was, or something was down. You had the Doubletree right across the street, and then down they had the Adams Mark or the Westin something. It was one of those. It's the high rise down there in Tulsa, the Williams Center. And we walk. It's about three blocks. It's 115 degrees. We're walking back to the room. And Jane's saying, "What you gonna do?" I'm like, "God knows. Can you just let the Lord deal with me a little bit?" We get back to the room. I mean, you know, that message is ringing in my ears. I never take more than one step out of love. I get it straight. You know, Brother Hagin just talked about walking in love. Oh, brother. You know, if Copeland said it, I would say, "Well, that was Copeland. That's not Brother Hagin. I was doing something." You know. But it was Dad. We lay down to rest, and Janie, she don't let it go. "What you gonna do?" I said, "I guess I'm gonna forgive him." Now don't look at me in those tones that I see looking at me like, "I can't believe he did that." The reason I'm sharing this is because I know people are doing this exact same thing. That's why we're sharing this. And she finally leaves me alone. And I just lay there, and I said, "Lord, you're right. The word says I have to forgive and walk in love. I choose to forgive him for what he did." Now, that's been going on for 2 years. Mm-hmm. I was spun up for 2 years. I don't mean slightly spun up. I'm telling you, it took everything I had in me not, you know, and I was bigger back then. I was still in good shape. Anyway. Hallelujah. I could have taken him down easy and could have hurt him easy. And wanted to envision, dreamed about it. Yeah, dreamed about it. And come to church and preach faith. Didn't preach that service about faith working by love a lot during that time. I said, "Lord, I forgive him. Lord, I choose to release him of all indebtedness to me. Bless him. Thank you, Lord. I receive forgiveness for walking in unforgiveness. I choose to love him in the name of the Lord Jesus." I got a chance to find out how much I'm in it. Because we walk back over to the assembly center. I come walking in, and what's the first thing I see? "I love you, brother." I turned around, and for the first time in 2 years, when I turned around, the flush, the anger, and the desire to punch him out wasn't there. I was free. I mean, I was free. See, unforgiveness didn't put them in bondage. It put you in bondage.
Yeah, you're right.
You're the one that suffers the bondage. I was there to shake his hand, talk to him, and carry on with him. Now, what I didn't know was that the girl was with him right then. His wife kept tagging along behind him and the other woman who was the worship leader at their church. Come to find out, he was getting up in the pulpit, telling the church that they had a special, unique relationship. So if you see them down at the church by themselves, they're just, you know, it's because they're flowing in the Spirit together. They're working on things for, you know, yeah, they were working on some stuff. Uh-huh, uh-huh. They're working some things out, baby. I'm telling you. His wife would go into about diabetic, almost to a diabetic coma. He'd tell her to use her faith. He wouldn't call 911. He's waiting for her to die so he could marry this other woman and be free to do it. Well, you know, God couldn't deal with that situation until I let him go. And it wasn't 6 months after I got over and got in love and forgave and got out of my love that they called him in his office with her at 2:00 in the morning. And I mean, he wouldn't even let him in the room because they were getting after it. Man, the husband sued for alienation of affection and won.
Wow.
He won because they got his house, they got his land, they got everything. He got left out in the cold, and the rascal moved in with her and took it all. He sued and won. Well, anyway, God couldn't deal with that situation until I let go of it. And I'm telling you, why? Because if he had dealt with it and I was holding on to it, I'd have got burned. If I'm holding on to Greg and an electric line hits him, I get cooked. What's that?
Use Jerry as an example.
Use Jerry. Yeah, I was feeling the love. I said, Greg, if an electric line falls on Greg and I'm holding on to him, I'll get cooked. He said, use Jerry as an example. Can't you just feel that love just flowing out there? No, walking in love. We can't get around walking in love. Yeah. You can't take the communion table. Paul said to judge yourself, or you will be judged. That's why communion was so important in the church. It kept the love walk alive. It kept people walking in love one towards another. It kept things cleaned up. Amen. Like we said when we were preaching on that Sunday morning about love, I said, if the sun goes down on your wrath, somebody said, well, what happens if it's nighttime already? It's going down tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah.
You're still going to have to get, I mean, you got less than 24 hours to get that right because it's going to go down tomorrow afternoon. It'll come up and go, but when it goes down, it's going down. If you're still mad, it's on your wrath. You're violating the word of God. Well, you're preaching at me. I'm not preaching to anybody. This mess goes on in the church all the time. And it shouldn't happen in the church. Why do you think church splits take place? Because people get out of love.
That's right. Yeah.
There's never been a church split that took place in love. That went over big. People don't walk in love. They were fellowshipping and communing with the Lord around the Lord's table and judging themselves and judging their love. They wouldn't be doing those kind of things. Amen.
Yeah.
Then last week we talked about the powers of the coming world. I'm gonna finish this one next week because I didn't even get halfway through that last week. But I got on this line. Does somebody, the Lord, want me to talk about this morning?
Yes, really good. Yeah.
I'll tell you, folks, if we could get the church back to walking in love like that, we'd see more faith exploits.
You're right.
A lot of our faith things aren't happening because faith works by love. We're building all the faith scriptures. Hello?
Mm-hmm.
And we're not walking in love. Well, if faith works by love, you can have all the... What did Paul say?
Yeah.
He said, if I have faith to move mountains and have not love, I'm nothing.
Nothing.
And then in Galatians, he said, in Christ Jesus, whether you're circumcised doesn't mean anything, or whether you're uncircumcised doesn't mean anything. Only thing that matters is faith, which works... Now that word worketh, or works there, comes from a Greek word that means to be energized and empowered by. That's probably an oversimplification of translation, but that's it. By love. By love. Your faith is energized and empowered by love. You get out of love, your faith will stop working. That's what Dad Hagin says. He's real strong on that. You get out of love and it'll mess up your faith. You got people walking around making faith confessions and they're going, well, I don't know how it's not working. You're not walking in love. You keep walking out of love, your faith will be shipwrecked. You'll be making faith confessions and nothing's happening. I don't know. And you know what ends up happening? You know what happens to people who keep making confessions and keep believing and keep saying stuff and it never comes to pass? They eventually become unbelief. And if the root cause of it is because you're not walking in love, you're short-circuiting your faith, and you're building unbelief into your life, and you're about to set yourself up for a failure, to become shipwrecked in the lifestyle of faith.
So true.
It's imperative you stay in love. You can't stay out of love. You just don't know what they did to me. Well, I want to ask you something. Did they put spikes about that big through your wrist? Did they beat your back open with a Roman scourging session? Did they put thorns about an inch long on your head? Hello, did they spit on you and pluck your beard out? How many of you ever had somebody walk up and pull one hair out? Now, I get these little kinky hairs on the back of my, right here at the base of my hairline on the back. And Janie will be sitting rubbing my hair. She'll get a hold of it.
Uh-huh.
And I know what's coming next.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, no.
Ping! You're like, woman, you crazy? Now, what she'll usually do is she'll try to find the most inopportune times to do it when you can't do anything. Except go,
like driving.
Or with people around.
Yeah.
Look at that hair, honey. Couldn't you just lift it in and put some straightener on it or something? He plucked his beard out. Brother Bill, come here. Let me show him. That's a good one to work on. Just grab a hold of Bill's beard and go whack. You've had nothing done to you. I'm going to tell you, 90% of what people get mad about is emotional stuff. Their pride. Their pride gets hurt. They get their pride hurt, and they respond out of that soul. I'm telling you, you got to walk in love. Because if you don't, it's going to shipwreck you. And it's going to rob you of faith. And if it robs your faith, you're just going to end up on the spiritual shipwreck pile of ship. You're just going to be out there overcooked with the rest of them. Spiritual junk heap. Because you wouldn't watch your love walk. Wouldn't watch your love walk. It's real simple. And I'll tell you something, folks. You know why the Bible says you don't let it go down in your wrath? Let the sun go down in your wrath? It's a whole lot easier just to keep things straight every day. You don't have to keep tally books. Who you're mad with. Who done you wrong. Now just say amen, oh me, or help me, Jesus. What, something, you got to say something. Well, we've got, if we keep our love walk straight, our faith will work. Keep the church, that's why they came and took communion, because they kept the church in love, and when the church stayed in love, they stayed in faith. And when they stayed in faith, God worked special miracles and signs and wonders. The power of God was manifest, because they kept, their faith was working because they were walking in love. Get a bunch of junk in the church, it'll mess the church up. It'll take the life right out of the church.
Yeah.
Getting in unforgiveness and walking outside of love, it'll take the life right out of a church. Oh, hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the service. Thank you that Jesus is Lord. Thank you that we're making adjustments in all of our areas of our life, and one of the areas we're going to make sure we stay right with is in our love walk. Lord, we love you. We love the Father. We love the Holy Ghost. But we love our brothers and sisters who we see. And we walk in forgiveness one towards another. And if we have aught against them or they have aught against us, we get that straight. Because we're love beings. The love of God has been shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost. And we choose to walk in love and forgiveness. And let the Word of God restore our souls of any hurt and pain and anguish caused by actions of others. We choose to forgive them, and we choose to let the Word restore us. In Jesus' name, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here this morning, you're not born again. Now, I didn't ask if you joined the church, if you've been baptized, you've taken First Communion, gone through catechisms. I'm asking you, have you ever accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord? If you're here today, you've never received Jesus Christ as Lord, raise your hand. I want to pray with you. You've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord of your life, raise your hand. I want to pray with you. Anybody? All right. Anybody here say, Pastor Ed, I know I've been born again. I knew, but I've gone just like the prodigal son. I went out in the world. I'm backslid. I'm not serving God. I know it. I want to get right with you. If that's you, raise your hand. All right, one more offer. If you're here today, you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues. What do you mean by that? Exactly what Acts 2:4 says. They were all filled with the Spirit and began to speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. That's you today. You want to receive that baptism? We'll lay hands on you. You'll go your way filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues. Hallelujah. Have a divine communion with the Father. Raise your hand. All right. Now, I'm not going to ask you if you need to be healed. Lay hands laid on you. We have service tonight, healing and communion service. That's tonight. We'll be praying for the sick. If you know sick folk, bring them. If you need healing, bring yourself. If you know people that you can't get here, I mean, if you got somebody that lives 2 or 3 hours away, I understand that. Well, bring a hanky.
Great.
Amen. Bring a clean one, please. Bring a handkerchief. We'll lay hands on that in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And just like Acts 19, I believe 19:12 says, that God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, insomuch as aprons and handkerchiefs were taken from him, and they were laid on the sick, and they were healed, and the demon spirits went out of them. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Amen. We believe that the anointing of God, the healing anointing of God, is transferable, because the Word of God teaches us that it is. Amen. Brother Bill, I kept you busy today, hadn't I? It's like it when I just stand behind the podium, don't you? Oh, praise God. This was a moving sermon. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So we're going to walk in love, aren't we? Amen. We're going to walk in forgiveness, aren't we? We're a loving and forgiving people. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. So on May the 13th, 2012, we will have 100 people in service that morning.
Yeah.
Amen. In Jesus' name.
Amen.